Heart. Well, I'm going to read from Romans 14 if you want to look in your Bible. And kind of got a thought of a little Bible study on it, but it'll come out the way it comes out. Romans 14. I'm just going to read one verse. I won't read the whole chapter. I might cover a good bit of it. No, I just don't think I'm going to read the whole chapter. Verse 17. Paul said, "For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost." I'm going to preach tonight on Christian liberty. Now, the reason that Paul said that right there was because there was a lot of difference within this church body. It looks like to me that there were Jews that still hung on to some of the Mosaic teachings and Gentiles that didn't. Verse 1 says, "Him that is weak in the faith, receive ye him, but not the doubtful disputations. For one believeth that he may eat all things, and another who is weak eateth herbs. Let not him that eateth despise him that eateth not, and let not him which eateth not judge him that eateth, for God hath received him." I want you to really catch verse 4 in this chapter, okay? This is the key to this chapter, besides the verse I read. He said, "Who art thou that judgest another man's servant?" To his own master, he standeth or falleth. Yea, he shall be holding up, for God is able to make him stand. Brethren, I would hope you mature enough to take what I'm about to tell you. I'm not your master. Jesus is.
Amen.
That's good, ain't it?
Yes.
That means that I don't have to answer to you. I answer to God. In this text, Christian liberty is never to be abused. It's never to be debated. See what happened here. These Jews thought that these Gentile believers was eating meat that had been offered up to idols. And really, if you look at this scripture here, the weak people in this scripture were people that had Mosaic beliefs. It wasn't people that believed they had liberty to eat it. It was people that were saying they shouldn't eat it. See, it's backwards in this day. Most people think that the weak people are people that don't have, quote, their personal preferences or convictions, and they think they're weak. Both of these groups of people are seeking the Lord. After I preach this tonight, you'll see how much God convicts you about being somebody else's judge.
Yeah.
It's helped me. I'm not saying I've arrived for sure. I still got some of that in me. But I do want to say this tonight. No man is any other man's master. Now, it looks like there's three things here that they're having problems with. Number one is meat. Number two is days. And number three is wine. It says wine in the scripture here. And so it looks like to me here in the text, in the context, may I say, thank God that he's saying in verse number 4, thank God he said, we're under the authority of our own master. You're believers, and you're both seeking the Lord, and there's no need to clash, thank God, over my friend of preference. arguments or a personal conviction. Thank God that you think you're better than they are. And it only brings division in the body. And the Bible said, if God received them, we're to receive them. Amen. It's not talking about going against the Bible. It's not talking about doing things against the Scripture. But there is things in our personal life. Thank God that there becomes a personal preference or a personal conviction. And when we get it, we don't try to make other people do it. Right. I've done that before. I'll raise both hands and say that. Verse number 5. Look what he said. One man esteemed one day above another. There's no special days. I'm not going to kill this meeting tonight, but I just want to tell you this. God's the same every day. He just ain't going to manifest himself just because it's a certain day. He manifests himself when people want him. When they, thank God, friend, I look for him tonight. Look for him, amen, whenever we meet. And there, listen, thank God the Jews always esteem some special days. Yeah. Isn't there no special day? We're all in the same, hey, we're all, the day's the day. It's a resurrected day. Amen. I know that we to remember what Christ has done, but we're remembering the person. We're not remembering, amen. I mean, I know they had to remember Passover, the Jews did, but Jesus is our Passover. What he done, thank God, sufficient. We don't have to go back and serve no ceremonial law. Amen. My friend, thank God, he's as good to me today as he will be tomorrow. Amen. But it looked like to me, look what he said at the end of that verse. He said, let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. Be convinced in your heart, in your spiritual mind, what God wants for you. Amen. Listen to verse 6. He that regardeth the day regardeth it unto the Lord. And he that regardeth not the day to the Lord, he does not regard it. He that eateth to the Lord, for he giveth God thanks, and he eateth not to the Lord. He eateth not and giveth God thanks. The thing of it is, it's unto the Lord. That's what he's saying. Whatever we do, it's unto the Lord. If you can't do it unto the Lord, then you ought not do it. Amen. Verse number 7, I'm just going to go through the verses here and say a few things. For none of us liveth to himself, and no man dieth to himself. You live unto God, and you also affect others. A man that thinks that he can just do what he wants to when he wants to, and it don't matter what it affects others or not, Paul condemns that behavior in this scripture here. Yeah. But we do have accountability and live unto God and live under the thank God his judgment and we do because of our life have an effect on them that's around us. Yeah. Verse number 8, for whether we live unto the Lord. Whether we die unto the Lord. Whether we live, therefore die, we are the Lord's. He's expressing this fact that this problem of disagreement over these things, my friend, only is affecting the church to the place that they some think they're right, some think they're right on it. And he said, we're the Lord's. We live to him, we die to him. We're the Lord's people. And brother, when we realize that, thank God it'll help us. Amen. Yeah. For to this end Christ both died and rose and revived, that he might be Lord both of the dead and the living. Amen. He's over all, brother. He's over all. Amen. He's over everybody. Ain't nobody he ain't over. He's talking specifically to his people here. He said, I'm over them all. Who made you judge?
Right.
Verse 10, here it is. But why dost thou judge that? Why? He's asking the question. Why are you judging your brother for? Why dost thou judge thy brother? For why dost thou set at naught thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Why are you judging him for? I've never seen a day where people split over things that really don't matter.
Yeah, right.
whether a man ought a certain color shirt he wears, what kind of hairstyle he's got. That's crazy, ain't it? How his preaching mechanics are. Whether he really gets loud and wide open or whether he just gets up and talks. And what's happened is personal preference. That's what it is, really, if you think about it, is personal preference. I got personal preferences. You do too. I'm not going through all what I believe tonight as a personal preference. But I do know this. It's easy to judge people and look at people because they don't add up to what you think they ought to add up to. Who made you judge? Who is their master? Amen. Do you know what this does? I'm going to tell you what it does as a pastor in the Christ. It frees me up. It frees me up. Amen. Don't it free you up to realize, thank God that you're not nobody's master. Hey, God, he said, God accepted this people. Hey, God, that ate the meat. God accepted them. Why wouldn't you accept them? Amen. I mean, it's unbelievable. And there's things that I'm not going to get involved in. I believe that we need to look at the scripture and see what God says in it. Yeah. Amen. If I give you a New Testament Bible, I got an old and new. You say, what about the old? I say, well, the old's good, but we're in a New Testament church. You don't take Old Testament scripture and build New Testament doctrine. You learn off of it. It was for our learning. But we don't live in the old covenant. We're not, thank God, living under them old priestly ways. He's our priest. He's our high priest. We don't have to go to man to get our sin forgiven. We don't have to come in and offer up an animal sacrifice. We don't have to come in and say, well, the Jews had this diet. Amen. It's sanctified by the word of God in prayer. Yeah. Amen. That's right. Praise God. Yeah. If you want to eat pork, eat it. Right. It will run your blood pressure up. That's up to you. So what you going to say about it, preacher? I ain't going to say one thing. That's your business. Yeah. It's your body. It ain't mine. Right. It's God's body, really. Yeah. It's God's body, but... Praise God. Amen. You got to realize what I'm preaching. I really can't get too deep in it, but I don't think we can take it enough. And it just really busts up a lot of things we've been taught what tradition is. And it just about killed the church. Because if there's ever been a judgmental people that's been raised in this Christian ranks, it sure would be the Baptist. Yeah. And add Pentecostal with that too, because that's who you end up arguing with all the time. Amen. Yeah. Whether certain things are right and certain things aren't right, and all I can take is what the Bible says and what the Word of God says. Amen. And I've even known preachers, I don't know them, Brother Melby told me about them, and he said they wouldn't even let a man preach, thank God, if his wife had used canned biscuits. That's right. If he had two coats. I know places that you can't carry a Bible in. The only Bible they have is on the pulpit. And what they'll do is if they got a meeting, they'll got the Bible on the pulpit, and I told Brother Dennis about it, the preacher will grab it and he'll go out there and hand it to the preacher's lap and said, it's the will of God. They'd think if you use any notes at all that God wasn't helping you. What's that got to do with it? It's the Holy Ghost. It don't matter what a man's got. As long as he's got truth and got the Holy Ghost, what else matters? We're splitting hairs and having preferences and everything else, whether short-sleeve shirts, long-sleeve shirts. It's all, my friend, a man-made deal. And what happens here, these people say they ought not eat meat. And one day, hey, God says it's all right to eat meat. And what happened out in the church, God said, you're not their master. That's what he said. Amen.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable, and I know the church has authority. God give it to them. But it's unbelievable what churches come up with in their minutes and everything that they believe that they apply to church membership besides just being born again and being baptized. Somebody said they can't join the church. So I said, you wouldn't even let the woman at the well testify in your church. Amen.
Yeah.
She had been married 5 times, had a man that wasn't her own husband. God, Jesus saved her. Amen. That's right. I'd be glad for her to sing and testify. I believe in grace. I believe God forgives people, don't you? I don't believe God brings her sin back up. I don't believe God says anything about their past after he's done taking it away.
Amen.
That's right. But you know what?
Yeah.
People bring your past up, won't they? They'll bring your past up. They'll say, yeah, I know that fella. Yeah, look what he done. He's done this and that. But God don't. And people get in these things about all these other things and say, well, we don't believe that and we don't believe this. And what it is plain out division. And Paul said, don't get in the place of their judge. Amen. Listen to me. For when you judge somebody, you got to be measured with the same judgment. Let me tell you this. You go around saying, I don't believe they're right with God. Just go around and say that. Now, I've done it.
Yeah.
Still do it. I really don't say it in my mouth as much as I used to. But I think it in my heart. But I'll tell you, listen to what I'm about to tell you. You know what God will do? He'll put you in a spin. You know what he'll do? He'll get you to a place and you'll say, I wonder if I'm right with God. And what comes to my mind? Wait a minute, I said that man wasn't right with God. He measures that same judgment on you. He's going to test you. He'll allow you to be tested when you put judgment on people that you're not their master. Amen. Hey, listen. I am no man's master. I'm not a lord over God's heritage. This is God's flock. I'm the pastor here overseeing what God wants me to do as a man of God. And it's more than preaching. It's more than preaching.
Yeah.
It's keeping a spiritual habitation where the Holy Ghost has liberty to move and we have sound doctrine and truth that people can grow by the grace of God in. But I'm telling you, the problem is, I remember this old fella preached on this. I was a young Christian, and you know, I was a hyper in that stuff. I mean, I'd cut anything, cut anybody about, amen. And this old fella preached on what I preached all night. And I said, boy, I like that message you preached on Romans 14. And what he said, you've been judging people, hadn't you? That's what the chapter's talking about. Amen. Been judging people. Hey, it's easy to judge somebody else. Judge yourself. You know what I catch sometimes thinking about? I think about, wonder why they doing that, and Holy Ghost said, why have you done it? And then we won't be spiritual. Tell everybody what we believe and what we don't believe. Amen. Notice this here. He said here in verse 11, for it is written, as I live. I want you to catch that. As I live, saith the Lord. He is living. He ever lives. Every knee shall bow to me and every tongue shall confess to God. Everybody. Amen. Notice verse 12. So then every one of us shall give an account of himself to God. That means we're going to be judged. And it won't be by no man. It'll be by God. Verse 13, let us not therefore judge one another anymore, but judge this rather, that no man put a stumbling block or an occasion to fall in his brother's way. Now you hear me gladly, and I know people's going to buck some on this, but it's just the truth. If I know something offends Brother Danny, that's something that's really highly preferable or you have a personal conviction about.
Right.
And I know I'm coming around you and we're going to be together that day, then my responsibility is not to offend you.
Amen.
Not to put a stumbling block in front of somebody. Not to do it, just to do it and be a smart aleck about it. Amen. You to humble yourself and say, Brother Danny don't believe the way I do on it, but I love Brother Danny, and I ain't going to put a stumbling block in front of him and cause him to err or fall because I done it.
Amen.
That's right, isn't it?
Yeah.
Amen.
Right.
Somebody said, somebody asked me one time, why you kind of try to don't do them things around certain people? I said, because it causes them to stumble.
Amen.
Why do you think I think we ought to have a dress code in the church and I can't rule you outside this church unless you're going out here bringing this complete shame on the name of God? I ain't your master, but as a pastor, I say this is a spiritual atmosphere and we ought to come with spiritual minds. You coming in here looking like we're going to the beach? I'd say something about it. I'd come to you and say, hey, that just ain't the proper way. I love you in the Lord, and I ain't going to jump on you and make a big deal about it. But at the same time, we got to have some dress codes at the house of God. And if you got them in your heart, you will. But at the same time, I'm not policing you. I'm not your Lord. I'm not your master. That's your business between you and God. Long as you're not bringing a shame out here and my prayer to getting drunk and living like the devil.
Right.
Isn't that right?
Amen.
Well, that's right.
Amen.
Amen. Why should, that's right. I mean, if when we fear God more than we do man, we're doing pretty good.
Amen.
Well, I wonder what old Aaron's going to say about it. Wait a minute, I thought I saw that man taking a chew. I'm not his master. There's things worse than chewing tobacco. Isn't that right? You say you advocating. I ain't advocating. I'm just telling you, praise God, there's things worse than that. Your tongue's worse than that. James took a whole chapter and wrote on the tongue. The tongue can destroy a church faster than a man chewing tobacco. That's his business. He's just spitting it out. I'd rather see somebody spit brown, thank God, than spit out a bunch of gossip and slander.
Amen.
You say, oh my goodness, preacher, you mean we can have God and chew tobacco if God helps you?
Right.
I know preachers preach different than that, but they can take what they want to. I drank a good cup of large coffee today from Hardee's.
Yeah.
And I liked it. And I'll be honest with you, it relaxed me a little bit. What's wrong with it? Unless God makes it wrong, and it is against what my wife says, you ought not be drinking caffeine, because my heart get weaker when I drink it. I'm taking Bud Woolley's philosophy on that. Well, when it's my time, I'm going. I told him, I used to pick with him, I said, Papa, you know that eating all that gravy ain't good for you. He said, now, Joy, now you better listen to me. I've been eating this gravy all my life and drinking this coffee, and when it's my time, he's going to take me.
Right.
Now, that might be true, but it might be a harder road when you go in disobeying what you ought to eat.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Might have a whole lot rougher road to go. That's right, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know, it really gets on my nerves, these people think they got everything right. Gets on my nerves. Every hire's in place, and I mean, everybody, they wouldn't dare take their coat off. They wouldn't dare unbutton their shirt. And they got to have everything right, man. I mean, just everything. I've seen people like that. It look like, they just a perfect person. I don't really like hanging around people like that. I like people just who they are. The common people heard him gladly.
Amen.
Why are you trying to put on a show or try to act like something you ain't? There's a lot of things I don't like. You do too. You got things you don't like. Amen. But the thing of it is, I'm not to do anything that's going to cause somebody to stumble. I don't chew tobacco, but if I did, I wouldn't chew it around you. I don't know why I'm on chewing tobacco, but it's real. Because I used to chew it. I honestly tell you this, by the grace of God, today I got saved. He took it away from me. He did. It's amazing. He took tobacco the day I got saved and never have had another piece. But I wanted to, but I didn't. Well, it smelled good. Really? Yeah. That's right. Amen. Hey, people that smoke, they'll tell you that when they quit smoking every once in a while. But you know, that gives me sinus problems. I can't be around that. Hay does. If I get behind a truck hauling hay, it's bad. Amen. I mean, it just flares up. It's like drainage. I can't be around that. I couldn't chew neither. God liable to kill me. But the thing of it is, why are we caught up in all these differences about things? And we say, that man can't be right with God. How do you know that? If he's disobeying the scriptures and he's openly in drunkenness, openly in adultery or fornication or some sin, my friend, that's just open sin, and he practices that lifestyle, of course we can judge the fruit by the tree or the tree by the fruit. We know that. But still, thank God, we ought not go out and destroy somebody of their tongue. That's because we don't agree what they're doing. I won't tell you this. I preached this at the jail yesterday, and I'm going to insert this in. Slander is using your tongue with the intent to hurt somebody and make them look less than you.
Yeah.
Makes me look big. If I can say, that old guy over there, he says he's a preacher. Look how he looks. Makes me look big. That's sin. That's sin. I'm not no better than nobody. Are you?
No way.
You're not no better than nobody.
Sir.
I thought this last time, unless they reprobate people, men put their pants on the same way.
Mm-hmm.
They go to the same doctors and get shots.
Yeah.
They use the same porta johns when they gotta go. Ain't that right?
Yeah.
What makes you any better? What's wrong with the Baptist people? Well, praise God, will you? Well, that don't mean nothing to God. It's what's in your heart that means something to God.
Yeah.
I'm doctrinally truth. I got doctrinal truth in me. It's in me. It just comes out.
Yeah.
That's right.
Holy Ghost don't spit out error. You said you're right on everything. Not everything, but I am what God tells me and what he gives me in his book.
Yeah.
You can't better what he says. It ain't about feelings. Oh, I felt something. Well, what if you didn't? It don't change the truth. Ain't that right? Hey, don't be a stumbling block. That don't mean you're going to please everybody. There's always somebody going to say, well, he said it again. Or he done that again. Well, grow up. Grow up. Everything ain't going to be the way you want it. If you think it is, you have to go get your own castle. And don't go outside. For sure, you'll mess it up. That's the way people think. Well, it didn't go my way today. Join the crowd. Well, I really didn't agree with the preacher. Well, join the crowd. God help you. You can't dare say nothing to him. My wife used to have an uncle like that. He's pitiful. He lived up there in Maryland. That ought to tell you a little something. And you could, I asked him one time, I said, where you go to church yet? Oh, don't say that to him. That'd upset him. Honey, could I get you a cup of coffee? That made me want to throw up. God help. What's wrong with people? I mean, if my wife come to me like that and say, honey, could I please get you a cup of coffee? I'll say, what's got into her? We just like that. You know what I'm saying? We don't need that kind of stuff. I'm sorry you upset. The dog will come back.
I just can't.
Isn't that pitiful? I mean, it's pitiful. Ain't that pitiful?
Yeah.
I mean, we live in a day and time, thank God, where people so weak, amen, you can't say nothing to them. They're looking for a fault. I come visit your church. That one woman come, some guy brought him, and I got happened to get on that morning about Obama, and she said, well, I ain't never going back to that church, him preaching against the president. I thought, under God, you'd find something else out. You think I'm going to cut it because of what you are? I love you too much. I'm going to be who I am. Everybody's got a vote. I don't have no authority over you besides the God-given authority to lead the church. I don't tell you what to do or who to vote for. I tell you who not to vote for. But I will tell you this, you got to vote in the church. That's right, ain't it? Why be a stumbling block? Why does people go against everything everybody else wants to do? Anybody against it? I think we ought to give a Bible to so-and-so. Anybody against it? You know why? Didn't ask them.
Yep.
I'm getting in it, buddy. Who's masters over you? God's over you. Ain't that right? Amen. That's right, ain't it?
Sure
you, I'm not your master. Have I ever told you what to preach?
No, sir.
Have I ever told you what not to preach?
No, sir.
That's right. Why? God's his master. And if he got up and preached some kind of heresy or something, I say, Brother Danny, I think you need to reconsider that
yeah.
now.
Amen.
That's right. That's got you. How can we say that Brother Shank's God's man? I can tell him where to go and where not to go.
Yeah.
Well, he's God's man and my man. Should I call somebody and ask them? Well, thank God this Methodist church we're growing up in. They call me and they want me to preach Sunday, and I'm gone. Wait a minute. I got to call so and so and ask them, can I go? Brothers, you laughing about it, but the independent Baptist churches is run like that. They run like that. And if you do what they don't like, and I've done it before, I don't know if I'll do it again or not. I might. They'll get up and preach about it.
Yeah, they will.
I'll tell you what, I don't like what he did. I'll let him know from the pulpit.
Yes, sir.
I didn't say I wouldn't do it again. I might. I don't want to because I know that's not Holy Ghost preaching.
Amen.
But I will say this. Every man, the Bible says here, has his own master. I got to go here. Verse 14, I know and persuaded by the Lord Jesus that there's nothing unclean of itself. Buddy, that's strong right there. He said nothing's unclean of itself. Really, it's what you do with it. Here's the thing. Somebody said, is it sin, preacher? If God tells you it is.
Yes, sir.
Now, if the Bible tells you a sin, it's sin. If God told me in my heart, and I was praying, if he said, I don't never want you to read the newspaper again, if I don't listen to him, it's sin. Now, if I got up and told you that you ought not read the newspaper again, I'd be wrong. But if God told me that in my heart and made that a heart issue with me, there ain't nobody else can tell me what to do but God in that matter.
Amen.
Brother Edgar Thomas, a great preacher, man of God, he's gone to be with the Lord. Now, remember what he said? He was a state champion in the checkers. What'd he say? He said, the Holy Ghost said, Edgar, don't ever play it again. He said, Brother Jewel, I hated to do it. But I gave it up for God. He said, because I knew if I'd have done it after God made it an issue with me. But I don't think it'd be wrong for me to play a game of checkers. I just ain't no good in it, and I'm not interested in it. But it was to him. So Edgar didn't get up and tell you it was a sin to play checkers, but it was a sin to him. I'm helping you tonight if you'll listen to me. I know this ain't just like a preaching night, but it is help to you in these scriptures and get you out of judging people, everything you see you don't like. God help me with it. Notice here that nothing unclean of itself, but to him that esteemeth anything to be unclean to him. That's what I said. That's exactly what I said. I didn't know what the rest of the verse was saying. To him it is unclean. If Danny was like Lester Roloff, we wouldn't have fried chicken. We'd say, boy, hey, you know he went to Landis Baptist Church, and this was told to me by Mr. Richard Horn, the pastor there. He said when Brother Roloff come, he wouldn't let one of them girls touch a soft drink or a candy bar, nothing that defiled their body, what he called defiled. That's what he said. He preached dietary law about for salvation, which is not right. And I love Brother Roloff. He helped me in my early ministry. But the fact of it is, if it's unclean to him, it is. But if it ain't unclean to me, I'm going to drink the Coca-Cola. Yes, notice this here. But if thy brother be grieved with thy meat, and thou walkest thou not charitably, love your brothers, what he's saying. Destroy not him with thy meat for whom Christ died. He said, don't destroy him by doing things that's causing him to be offensive to. Verse 16, let not then your good be evil spoken of. Don't abuse your freedom. He said, don't use your liberty for occasions of the flesh. Don't find a starting point to doing things you ought not do that cause your brother to be offended at it. Yeah. Verse number 17 I read, you know what that means? It's all spiritual. Righteousness is imputed, peace is rest with God, and joy is the gladness of heart. He said, that's what the kingdom's about. It ain't about what you eating. It ain't about what you eat. It ain't about the day. It ain't about these ceremonies. It's not about that. It's about righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. That's what it's about. Amen. Verse 18, I'm headed there. For in he that in these things serveth Christ is acceptable to God and approved of men. Shows Christian love to the weaker brothers, what he's saying right there, when you don't do things that would offend him. Verse 19, let us therefore follow after the things which make for peace and things wherewith one may edify. He said we ought to do things that build up one another and not tear down one another. Amen. I love you. God bless you. Sure good to see y'all tonight. Good to see you.
Good to see you.
I like that white shirt.
Thank you.
I'm trying to edify you. Thank you for reading your Bible, having the Word of God, being in church. You don't go up to somebody and say, you sure don't look too good today.
I bet.
Can I tell you this? If you can't say nothing edifying, don't say it at all. If this church, and I love all of you, but if this church could learn that, you'd be better off. Learn there's a time to shutteth thy lippeth. That means hush. Levi used to come home when he was little, and the other party taught him, the kids did. He was little. He didn't know no better. We'd get taught, and he'd go, hush. Then he got to, hush your mouth. He went about 2.5, 3 years old. But I got to think about that. There's some people need to hush. Because they don't say edifying things. Now, I kid with a lot of people, you know, and people know my mechanics and they know how I am. I can say things to people. My grandpa's like that. You can say things to people and get by with it because they know you're just picking with them anyway. But you don't go up in a serious attitude and say things that's going to discourage and tear down people. Preaching is going to tear down some of your stuff because it's geared to reprove you in some areas of your life that it might tear it up and build it up right. But it don't give a church a place, thank God, to be so stinking opinionated about things they don't agree with. That's what he's saying. Nobody should be overly opinionated about these things. Everybody's got an opinion like you got a nose on your face. It don't mean it's right. Everybody's nose is different. Verse number 20, for meat destroy not the work of God. All things indeed are pure, but it is evil for the man who eateth with offense to offend. Verse 21, it is good neither to eat flesh nor to drink wine nor anything whereby thy brother stumbleth or is offended or is made weak. Listen, Brother Dennis, it would bother me. People leave and get mad, and even people I preach to outside the church. I understand people's not going to like preaching. They're not going to like the Word of God, Brother Joe. Sometimes they're going to get offended. They're not. There's sometimes they just don't like it. Years ago, I had people leave, and they wouldn't even shake my hand. They was mad. I've had people do all kind of things, you know, they didn't like. But the thing of it is, if somebody said, well, I didn't go back to that church because I didn't like what the preacher preached, then, but what would bother me is if I really offended somebody over something that would be not serious about the, you know what I'm saying? If your loved one come and I was arrogant to them, snobby to them, said something out of the way to them, and then they said, well, I ain't going back to that church. Why? Well, the preacher talked to me wrong. That'd be bad. It really would.
Yeah.
Wouldn't it?
Amen.
Not over preaching, but over something that's just kind of trivial. Like a visitor comes and you come in, you know, and he's got a ponytail, and you say, you could use a haircut. Is that the best clothes you got? How dumb is that? Or something somebody's got on that you don't really approve of? I'll say this again. I mean it. There ain't nobody in here to tell anybody about dress attire. If anybody does, I'll tell them. Now, about your own house, that's your business. And if you don't like what your wife puts on, tell her. But you better do it in the right spirit, or you'll come to church with a bad one. That's right. And if she don't like what you got on, then just talk about it. But the thing of it is, when it comes to the body of Christ, nobody is the police of the church.
Amen.
That's why we have unity, because we ain't got a bunch of long tongues trying to tell people what to do and what not to do. Amen.
Yeah.
I think that's the pastor's work of instructing people in the things of God. But I think a lot of times people's offended and been a stumbling block to people over their tongue. And the thing of it is, he said, and I can add to that, he said, nor anything whereby thy brother stumbled. Anything. Verse 22, hast thou faith? Have it to thyself before God. I like that. Keep your personal convictions to yourself. Happy, boy, you better get a hold of this. Happy is he that condemneth not himself in the thing which he alloweth. What's that mean, preacher? Well, the way I interpret that right there is a man's got happiness over liberty that he has peace about. That if his heart don't condemn him, then he has confidence toward God. Amen.
Yeah.
That means if Donald Hip wants to jump on the trampoline and he's got peace about it, and his heart don't condemn him, jump. Amen.
Yeah.
That means if you want to go out and shoot your shotgun, do it. Even if your neighbor don't like it. Amen. That means that you can't look at somebody. Listen, I could get in a lot of things here. I'm staying away from it because I'm not going to get controversial with it. But what that means is if I don't have condemnation and my heart don't
Amen.
Condemn me, then I'm happy with it.
Yes, sir.
Ain't that right?
That's right. Amen.
Praise God. Verse 23, and I'm through tonight. And he that doubteth is damned if he eat, because he eateth not of faith, for whatsoever is not of faith is sin. If you got doubt whether you ought to do it, you ought not do it.
Amen.
Them two verses go together kindly. You got peace about it? Do it. If it's not against God's scripture.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. That means if you thinking in your mind, well, I don't know whether I'll do this or not, then don't do it.
Amen.
Don't do it. Ain't that right?
Yeah.
There's a lot of things preached about. I preached about a whole heap of things, you know, back years ago, and I think some of that stuff still needs to be preached. But a lot of it needs to be put out back, you know, because it was just following what group you was in. It's from what you hear, you know, you say, yeah, I like that. It sounds right, you know. Let's just use an example here. Everything should be done in moderation. You agree to that, don't you? Some women don't think it's right to wear makeup. But there's nothing wrong with makeup if it's in moderation. Everything's done in moderation. If a woman don't wear earrings, don't wear them. If you want to wear them, wear them. Nobody's business. Ain't that right? Unless they look like, praise God, fishing lures. And then still, it's really their business. Isn't that right? Isn't that still their business? Huh? I know we laugh some of the night, but buddy, it's some gospel truth in this. It sure is. You say, what you trying to get us to? Liberty? Maturity? And not saying, well, the preacher said I can do what I wanted to. No, I didn't. I said you can do what God allows you to do in the Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. That's right, isn't it?
Right.
Amen. And that's what he's teaching in this chapter. Quit judging everybody. What kind of shoes I got on don't make me a man. What's in my heart? I like tie shoes. I really like tie shoes. I hardly ever wear shoes without ties. I mean, you know, shoestrings. I just like them. I hardly ever go without my shoes. I wear them tonight till I take them off. Go to bed. That's just the way I am. Some people like to go barefooted everywhere they go. What's the deal? Who cares? What's that got to do with anything? Amen. But see, we get our preferences in these things and say, did you see that woman? She had on flip-flops. Well, I'll tell you what, there's a time and place for everything. My mama taught me that. But at the same time, I'm still not your master. Ain't that right? You can have a good time in God and enjoy life, and you don't have to wonder and say, oh, me. Oh, me. I stopped at this store here in the mountains, and it had redneck store. And I know in the back of it, it's got moonshine in it. But, boy, I won't go in there and buy that hat that's got that sign on it. It says rednecks only. And I don't know if I ought to go in that store or not. Danny might see me. God tells you not to go in, don't. Yeah, I mean, why is people living in straitjacket religion? You know why? I'm going to tell you why. Preachers just preach that way. You can't hardly spit without looking around saying, I wonder if they saw me spit. Who's your master? Who judges you? Amen?
Yeah.
You're your own. Hey, God is your master. But I'm going to say this. Everything in that book we ought to do, don't you believe that?
Yes,
that he's given us. And we ought not never abuse the scripture to live the way we want to.
Amen.
But there's more Christian liberty than what you'd really like to agree to.
Oh, absolutely.
You know why? Because it makes you feel spiritual and religious because you do what you do. Instead of pleasing the master.
Yeah.
That old guy had to get that awl in his ear. Remember that? He served him 7 years. He said he could leave. He said, no, I want to stay with my master. Put that awl in his ear. He's a servant for life. Amen. Thank God. That don't mean you can go out and get earrings in years, men. We ain't wanting to look like women. God's against that. Amen.
That's right.
God help us. All right, I appreciate you hearing me tonight. That's just a little old lesson on that scripture. I think it'll help you. It really will help you spiritually if you'll listen to it. Brother Keith, pray for us tonight.